Hey, what's up, guys? TX3089 here. It is Tuesday, April 1st, but you guys should be watching this on April 2nd. There is a lot of information I need to talk about in this video. We're going to be looking at Naval Strike, the carrier assault game mode that I was talking about in the TDM video. If you guys haven't seen the Team Deathmatch Naval Strike video that I uploaded about 3 or 4 days ago, I'll leave an annotation on the video and a link down in the description area below. Now moving on to the video itself, I gotta say that Naval Strike is a huge welcome and a beautiful map pack that has been added to the Battlefield 4 series, and it is actually very confusing. I don't know if you guys have been watching videos. I know some of you guys have played this game mode before that had a different name, I believe, in the other Battlefield video games. But for those of you that really don't have an idea on how this works, I will be explaining the game mode in depth. And there is a lot of information to talk about as well when it comes to Naval Strike. Now, for those of you that really like watching videos without a commentary track, I will be uploading this video on Friday without a commentary track, just for the fact that I feel that the video flows really well. I captured 3 hours of Naval Strike footage over the weekend, and I was able to cut it down to this 11-minute video. The great and cool thing about this video is that it feels like you're watching one round of carrier assault. What I did is I added the first half is basically me capturing and fighting for flags, and then the other half of the video is me inside a carrier and fighting to basically blow up the MCOMs of the enemy. So I really hope you guys enjoy the work that went into this video. And once again, if you want to watch this without a commentary track on top of it, I will upload it on Friday. Now moving on, for the rest of the video, you are going to be watching some AK-5C weapon gameplay. I gotta say that this is one of my favorite weapons when it comes to Battlefield. Unfortunately, my G36 just didn't work out the way it did like in Battlefield 3. X-Factor, I believe, uploaded a video explaining the patch that went into the G36, and I'm really hoping that the recoil was fixed when it comes to the G36, seeing as how from the title he says that it resembles the M16A3, which is a dearly missed weapon for a lot of you players from Battlefield 3. Fortunately for me, I never really got into that weapon, and I never really care enough about a weapon for me to miss anything. And this guy really messed up. He should have shot me instead of trying to knife me. But anyways, for the AK-5C, I am using the Prisma 3.4 times scope. This is my favorite magnification slash scope in the game for any weapon. I use it on my LMGs because it gives me a beautiful vision, or it shows the trails of the bullets traveling, and it gives me a good indication of when I should let go of the trigger to control my recoil. And it's just a beautiful scope for me to use. Aside from that, I'm using the green laser sight. As you can see, I even have the relish camouflage slash color for the gun. I really love the color green. Just recently, I unlocked the camouflage for the soldier, or the skin that has like a green leafy color to it. So I'm really representing the green in Battlefield 4. The suppressors, unfortunately, don't have any positive or negative effects from each other, so I kind of went with the prettiest one, and that is the LS06 suppressor. And for the under barrel, we have the folding grip. The great thing about the AK-5C is, of course, the great stability. You get a nice low recoil with the weapon. You're able to do long burst without missing. I noticed that the weapon itself has a really great aim and long burst, which really helps me with medium to long range enemies, and I'm able to kill them pretty fast and pretty easily as long as I control the burst. And you're definitely going to be watching this in this clip right now, and also just take a close listen. I don't know if you guys are able to hear that beautiful metallic sound as soon as you release the trigger, there's a really nice metallic sound that I get from the AK-5C. I don't know what it is, I don't know if any other weapon does this sound, but it just mesmerizes me. I love that sound, I love everything about the AK-5C, and if you haven't used this weapon, I really suggest that you give it a try, and I'm pretty sure that you'll fall in love with it. I even chose this after the ACWR, and the ACW was one of my favorite weapons when it came to many video games, and this thing just took over that really easily. So now moving on to Carrier Assault, there's a lot of information to talk about. There's a lot of different outcomes, there's a lot of different ways to play Carrier Assault. So first of all, let's move on to what this is. Basically, you're going to start out with 100 points per carrier. Your job for I'm not going to say half of the game, but maybe half of the game, is to capture as many flags as you can. The more flags that you get, the more damage that you're doing to the enemy carrier. Each flag that you have has a rocket launcher that is going to your enemy ship, and that is making the enemy ship lose one ticket or one point. Once again, your ship and the enemy ship starts with 100 points. As soon as any carrier that reaches 50 points has the it's breachable. You're able to go inside and plant these MCOMs. Now here's the tricky part. After either ship reaches 50 points, you can either stay outside, you know, doing the same thing as you were doing from the beginning and capture flags and continue doing 1 point or 1 point damage to each ship, and I'm explaining why this is important in just a second, or you can either go to your own ship and defend it if your ship is the first one that reaches 50 points, or you can go to the enemy ship and try to plant the MCOMs if their ship was the first one to reach 50 points. The other thing here is that when both ships reach 50 points, you're gonna have to see what you're gonna do. Are you gonna want to defend your own carrier? Are you gonna try to win the fight by planting the MCOMs at your enemy's carrier? So this is really confusing. Another thing here is that I noticed that if neither of both teams are able to plant the MCOMs, then the team with the most tickets are gonna win. This is why it is very important for you to decide, are you gonna stay outside and continue capturing flags and continue doing basically minimal damage to maybe win a game at the end? Or are you gonna go to your enemy's carrier and try to plant the MCOMs, or are you gonna stay in your own carrier and defend the MCOMs? Another cool thing here is that both carriers have the same design. It doesn't matter if you're on your own or on the enemy's, you have the same design. When the ship or the carrier reaches 50 points, you get 2 entry points per ship, and this is actually really hard to get in there. I was watching Level Cap's video and I was really trying to enter a carrier with a helicopter or I forgot the name of that helicopter that basically that carries 8 passengers. If you're able to fly that thing in there, you might be able to take out everyone in there, but unfortunately I wasn't able to give that a try. But as you can see here, I really had a great team. We were just dominating the enemy team. And this is the crazy part here, is that as soon as you take over, you can cover these 2 entryways on top. Your team, the team that is attacking, cannot enter these entry points. Only the defending team is able to exit the ship with these entry points. And there's a total of 3 entry points, if I'm correct. There's these 2 that you see right now, and there's one on the left side of the soldier right now, or behind me. And you'll probably be able to see me attacking enemies that are exiting the 3rd entry point later in the video. So, once again, it's actually really tricky. If you're a rush player, you're gonna get your little rush moments in this gameplay or in this game mode. If you're a conquest player, you can continue defending the flags even though your team is defending or attacking the carrier ship. I really hope I was able to explain this correctly. It's actually pretty confusing, but it's a lot of fun. I really had a lot of fun. I had a great team with me. And even though the second day wasn't as successful as this first day, I really enjoyed it. Once again, the only problem that I have with these DLCs is for the fact that they're only available with the new maps. At one point, it just gets boring playing the same maps, which is one of the reasons why China Rising, I believe I have less than 2 hours in China Rising, just for the fact that I found the maps a little boring, a little big. I wasn't able to play with the vanilla maps. Same goes with Second Assault. I'm not able to play those maps with the original maps, and just playing the same maps over and over again gets really boring. Another huge problem that we're having right now with the PlayStation 4. I don't know if the Xbox is having this issue. I don't know if you guys from the PC community are having this issue, but we're having a huge problem with the lag. This was a bad thing when it came with vehicles, just for the fact that you're rubber banding back and forth. And aiming is just, you can't aim. As soon as you try to point at something, you get this rubber band, you move your joystick, and it messes up everything. Now, an even worse problem now is that you weren't getting that rubber banding as a soldier. Well, I wasn't getting that problem as a soldier. And you probably saw in about three clips back, I was kind of rubber banding running as infantry. And this really sucks. I found myself quitting a lot of games trying to get some good footage, and I really hope that they fix this rubber band issue, as it looks like everything else has been fixed. Once again, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Please give it a like if you guys did like it. I am TX3089 from Los Angeles, California, and I'll see you guys on the battlefield.